Today, I'm going to talk about a very simple idea. A very simple idea that provides us with unique insights on fundamental questions for the human condition. I'm sure most of us, well, probably all of us in the audience, at some point in time, have asked ourselves, why are some people healthy and others are not? Why are some people happier than others? Or maybe, why are some people successful and others are not? These are important questions that matter to all of us. A very simple idea that allows us to at least attempt to answer those questions is simply observing people over time, or observing large groups of people over long periods of time. In the statistical jargon, this is called observing people longitudinally. What is perhaps not very well known is that in the UK, we observe people over time quite a lot. This is a good thing. The UK is home to the largest, in terms of sample size, and longest-running studies of this kind compared to anywhere in the world. These studies follow the lives of people born as early as the 1930s, and they go up to the children of the new century, and a lot of studies in between. And by the way, this is not all. There are many more. Couldn't fit to the slide. I am the Chief Statistician of the Center for Longitudinal Studies at University College London, where we host four of those large population-based studies. Today, I'm going to focus on a unique subset of those, the UK's national birth cohorts. You may be thinking, OK, what is a birth cohort? Why it is different from the other longitudinal studies? Well, it's kind of, it's implied in the name. We follow people from birth and over their whole life course. And that's very important, as we shall see later. In the UK, we have four national birth cohorts that follow the lives of thousands of people. The earliest one started in 1946 and follows the lives of about 5,000 participants from birth onwards. The second one, the 1958 birth cohort, 12 years later, another generation, follows the lives of 17,000 people born in 1958. The third one, in 1970, another 12 years later, another 17,000 participants being followed from birth to adulthood. And the latest and more recent birth cohort follows the lives of about 18,000 millennials. But you may be thinking, how does a birth cohort look like? What is a birth cohort? And this is a bit of a messy slide, isn't it, right? A bit chaotic, yeah? Well, life can be messy. Life can be chaotic sometimes, right? And in our lives, we do generate a lot of information. A lot of things tend to happen. There are characteristics of our birth. Our parents have their own characteristics. Then we go to school, interactions with peers, the teachers. Everyone has a favorite teacher or a teacher we hate, right? And that can have an effect. Some of us go to university, the first job, the second job. Since we're hosted by LBS, the second job could be a startup, maybe, you know, all of that. Important decisions, children, relationships, and so on. Ever present from day one, or a bit before that, our health status, which is influenced from those events, and vice versa. The great thing about birth cohort studies is that by frequent visits to our participants from birth, from day one, or a bit before actually, large chunks of this data are being captured. The domains of the data, of the information we capture, a lot. Almost everything, really. These are just some examples. The information can be in the form of questionnaires, for example. It can be blood samples. It can be DNA. It can be accelerometer readings, and so on. Obviously, this information is being processed, and terabytes of data are being generated. Needless to say, we go at great lengths to safeguard the identity of the participants that trust us with such sensitive information, of the thousands of participants that trust us. So, a lot of information, a lot of data, which is great for science, right? But what are some of the findings? Because enough of the data. Let's get on to the serious stuff. What have we found? Most of the studies, some of the studies have been going on for a long time, and I think I suspect that some of the early findings today we take for granted. So, this is an advertisement from the 70s, which is trying to encourage women not to smoke during pregnancy. The 1958 birth cohort was one of the first studies that established the association between smoking during pregnancy and several outcomes, for example, like low birth weight or increased neonatal mortality. Subsequently, more associations were documented, like the effect of smoking during pregnancy on childhood obesity or childhood asthma. These findings have shaped public health advice and arguably are saving lives ever since. A robust finding, which is persistent in all generations, in all four generations that we observe, in all those birth cohorts, is that early life socioeconomic conditions have a long-lasting effect. Children born into socioeconomic disadvantage, they're more likely to do worse at school, they find it more difficult to get jobs, and they're more likely to suffer from poor health in their life course. And this effect is long-lasting. It doesn't stop in midlife. It goes up to age 60 and so on. It's all not negative. By being able to observe people's lives in the long run, at various stages of their life course, we're able to find out what happens to children that experienced some form of disadvantage, socioeconomic disadvantage, for example, but later on did better than expected. For example, it has been shown that parental investment partially compensates for the effect of early life socioeconomic disadvantage. Children whose parents read to them at age 5 were much less likely to be in poverty by age 30. However, we should consider what would these resilient children would have been able to accomplish if they hadn't experienced disadvantage in the first place. Generally though, parents, keep reading to your children, it can go a long way. So, early life matters and sets the stage for what happens later on in our life course. But by being able to observe people over time, we're able to find out what happens in adult life. One of the findings is that long-term relationships have a positive effect on health. We have also found that men and women that experience the upheaval of separation or divorce have similar health status to those in long-term relationships, as long as they enter, they form a new long-term relationship in the future. So, if you have recently separated, don't worry, your health will be just fine, as long as you start a new long-term relationship sometime in the future. That's the findings, you know. Not me, not my fault. So, well, you know, generally, the more time we spend in long-term relationships, the more likely we are to be healthy. It's long-term loneliness that has detrimental effects on health. Up until now, I have given you some examples of key findings. There are many more, obviously, of things that happen within generations, right? So something happens early on, and in early life, and might have an effect later. However, most of the change we observe in our societies is arguably due to differences between generations. One of the most striking differences between generations is the striking increase in life expectancy. By the way, I was told I shouldn't present graphs, but you can't keep a scientist away from graphs for that long. So, here's a graph of life expectancy in the UK from 1930 up to 2011. That's life expectancy at birth for men and women. Women expected to live longer than men. You see there is an upward trend, okay, a little bump here around the whore, understandably, but generally the trend is upward. So we're expected to live longer. Younger generations are expected to live longer than older generations. The dotted lines represent the year of birth of the generations we follow. Each younger cohort is expected to live longer. So great, we're expected to live longer, but a pertinent question is, are those added years years of good health? Are those added years years of good quality of life? And these are important questions and have implications for many things. Population aging, for example, the healthcare system, the labor market, pensions, and so on. We have recently started examining those trends. And this is an example of a comparison of mental distress symptoms, anxiety and depression, between two generations, between those born in 1970 and those born in 1958, at age 42. What we find is that men and women born in 1970 are more likely to suffer from symptoms of mental distress compared to those born in 1958. And this trend, this type of findings, is not specific to mental health. For example, other outcomes like obesity show similar trends. More recently born cohorts, younger generations, are more likely to be obese compared to previously born cohorts, older generations, at any stage of their life course. The implication here is that recently born cohorts, more recently born cohorts, younger cohorts are expected to live longer, but they're not necessarily healthier. I will finish my presentation by arguing that time is indeed on our side. The more we observe people, the longer periods of time we observe people we observe, the more we learn. Longitudinal studies can provide us with reliable empirical evidence to inform policies that will seek to address the major challenges the UK and the world are facing today. An aging population or growing inequalities, for example, among others. However, the full potential of the longitudinal studies hasn't been fully realized yet. I'm sure that most of you, if not all of you, have heard about the idea of big data. By the way, I hate the term big data, but that's what people use. So, big data, which is data that maybe the government collects on a daily basis, on a routine basis, on hospital admissions, birth certificates, educational attainment, you name it. By combining these two sources of information, the big data, with the refined information we have on thousands of people in the cohorts, in the longitudinal studies generally, we will be able to get an even more complete picture of someone's life or life course. The possibilities are truly endless. You may be thinking, great data, fantastic, but what about access? Who gets to analyze this data? Is it just you, George? No. Most of the studies are freely available to scientists worldwide to analyze. This is clearly a case of the more, the merrier. The more scientists analyze the data, the more we learn. And if it happens that two groups from around the world or the UK have a similar idea, no problem, that's great. Replication always promotes good science. Because longitudinal data are very powerful indeed, but we will only be able to maximize their potential if they're freely available. Thank you.